What's up, guys? Zomboid Man here. In this video, you'll see me get bitten for the fourth time.
Oh.
Now, I know the vaccine mod is controversial and all. Some people think it ruins the game because you don't have to worry about succumbing to the infection. Which is somewhat true, the only problem is, when loot is insanely rare, getting the materials needed for the vaccines is quite difficult. In fact, if I had not started in Durker Dam, which is a land of plenty, I wouldn't have had the resources available to me to make a lab, let alone a vaccine. And if I hadn't gotten lucky to find a level 1 vaccine on a CDCZ, wouldn't have had time enough to delay the infection sufficient to create my own vaccine. One goddamn time the CDC was useful and it's in a fucking video game. Every time I've been infected, it's always been a mad dash to find enough ammonia and sulfuric acid, which required me to push into newer territory, fighting both Zeds and time itself. Survival was never guaranteed. Survival was anything but guaranteed. Frankly, none of this would have ever even been possible if I wasn't already an experienced survivor. And of course, there are other ways to die. Anyway, all of that comes later. We'll pick up where we left off from the last video, with the arrival of yet another Storm Ward. If you haven't seen the last video, it covers my fight for a room at a local B&B in a place known as Over the River, against a not-so-inviting local populace. With this Storm Horde, I had mistakenly believed that they would be coming from the north through the military base because I thought I had killed just about everything else, everywhere else. So I tried to cut them off, using the ambulance once again as a distraction. But I was wrong, this Storm Horde outmaneuvered me.
Thank you.
next day my recording came out like this, so I'll spare you the headache of watching it and simply say that a change in drip was in order as I entered a new stop and smell the roses phase of my journey. But stopping to smell the roses was dangerous, as I'd soon find out on another of my many visits to the gun range.
Oh my fucking god.
As a part of my new smell the roses philosophy, it was time to start properly making a base of the bed and breakfast and to obtain a matching loadout and vehicle. So I downgraded from my more powerful weapons to a double barrel shotgun and a revolver, and I brought home a 91 Geo Metro to fix up. Air in my ass now looked like the sort of post-apocalyptic survivor zomboid man type freak show who would drive a Geo Metro. The next day I took the car out to the Millie base so I could torment the Zed stuck on the far side of the fence. Idiots. Then I thought it would be a good idea to blow myself up with a grenade. Idiot.
Oh my god. Dude, what the fuck?
There are plenty of ways to die in Project Zomboid beside getting bitten. Blowing yourself up is always a good one.
Oh, good thing I tested it like that. That's why I usually don't fuck with explosives, man. That went nowhere and blew up right there. Especially the handmade explosives. Like, there's a zombie, like, on the ground, getting trampled. He's getting trampled. Oh, they're getting up now, because I'm killing them. Okay, it's kind of nice that I was able to deal with that horde like that. Oh, fuck. I think I need to, like, stitch my arm. It's a deep wound.
Yeah.
Anyway, since I was in a military base, I thought I would find some medical supplies on location. Something with which I could stitch myself up. But that wasn't really happening, and because my health bar was continuing to drain at a worrying pace, I decided to play it safe and headed back to the B&B to stitch myself up there.
Then I go do something like this and I don't have that stuff with me because I'm in the beater and I'm like in a different town and I'm not fully set up, and then I just go to, like, you know, mess around, and then I do that to myself. Like, bro, is there anything more fucking just perfect way to get yourself fucking killed?
The next day, I set out to gather some supplies for mechanics from the vehicles I had previously dismantled. I have to say, I was enjoying the new loadout. In the afternoon, I decided to probe the entrance to the frigate on the water. I must say, I found it sufficiently save me. Not in the end. This place is cursed. On a brighter note, I spent the evening doing some chill homie mechanics in the Christmas Eve, I treated myself to an improved Geo Metro. Spent a wonderful weekend enjoying the Millie Base Resort and Day Spa, taking in the sights and having meaningful interactions with the other guests of the facility.
I don't feel no shame, it's a mood you lack. I go crazy, nah, but I ain't lazy. Track after track, I work on this shit daily. Pass me the jack, right as fuel, got me hazy. About to unpack all these things I've been chasing. I've got visions in my head, like memories after death. To be a legend instead of something you can forget. I'm living up every
every breath. I'd rather lead than be led. I'll feel the seeds as they spread with every word that I've said.
Then, as I continued renovations at the bed and breakfast, I was beginning to wonder if all of this was really necessary. Did I really need fences and security if I had already killed everything in a 10-block radius, as I had believed I already did? As it turned out, on the night of the 29th of December, the answer would be yes, as a horde rolled into the bed and breakfast and caught me with my pants down. Thank you. Springfield 1903 to get rid of all the pests stuck in the water before settling into some new fashion for the new year. In truth, I spent the better part of that day just in the shipping containers, trying to find a sniper rifle with a scope large enough to kill those harmless Zeds stuck in the water. But honestly, it was worth it because it was unsettling to hear them moaning whenever I was walking around the inside of the ship. On the 3rd of January, I was reminded for the umpteenth time that the Zeds are never truly gone. At least not in over the river. I got closer to finishing my base defenses, closing the west end off to traffic completely, and getting a lot of fence up on the east end.
I can plumb the toilet and get water out of it. You don't think I should do that? Alright, how about this? Okay. I will plumb a toilet, but I'll also plumb a sink and drink water out of that.
Now, if you've ever plumbed a toilet in Project Zomboid, I need you to let me know in the comments down below. I can't be the only one. Anyways, on the 6th, I went deeper into the frigate, finding more of its secrets and hidden passageways before finally making it onto the bridge itself.
But it really does feel like a ship. I can hear them moaning, but I think it's like ones that are... Oh, fuck. I just found my way out into the other... You know, when I was topside? This is topside. Look, if there's even a stop sign that says to stop.
Spent some time on ships, the map maker did a really fine job of making a ship experience that felt both authentic and appropriately scary for the post-apocalyptic genre, and at the same time adding a nice dose of Easter eggs and secrets there as well. After my trip to the frigate, I spent the next few days using a commercial truck to loot the military base a little more completely before crossing the eastern neighborhood off the map. The last place to clear in the over the river township was the McCoy logging compound. So I spent the 11th of January doing just that. Setting my first steps onto the mainland of Zomboid-infested Kentucky. somewhere between Louisville and West Point. With McCoy bending the knee about 45 days after my arrival over the river was conquered. So it was once again time for a trip change and to spend a few days reading and advancing my tailoring knowledge. If only I had done a little more. After finally conquering over the river, I spent about a week just putzing around the base, which I had grown quite fond of. I had a lot of fun there just doing random odds and ends, sitting around the campfire and simply living without any pressure to kill Zeds or loot or find food or to do anything at all, really. For what felt like weeks now when I decided to take the M240 machine gun out for a drive and somehow wound up fighting a considerable storm horde. Looking pretty good, and things to do around here were starting to dry up. So I began thinking about making a return trip to Durkerdam to continue working on the cure. So I made some test tubes and spent the entirety of January 24th gathering blood samples from the last storm horde. Not before a mini horde managed to break through my fence and give me a little scare. Seriously, how the hell are there even any of these fuckers around anymore? On the 25th, I finally made the return trip to Durkerdam. All those important vaccine materials, ammonia and sulfuric acid. Because I had been gone for 2 months, there were, of course, some respawns to deal with. Oh well. Now, if you've seen my first video, you know that the early Durkerdam footage was lost. You haven't seen my Durkerdam bases yet. So I'm including some footage from those locations here as a sort of impromptu base tour. The warehouse at the port is actually my second base, as I began in Pertville and simply based up in a two-story house there. The port became my next base after I escaped Pertville and also became the location of my lab. It's a relatively safe location with good geographical barriers, but Zeds do fairly often walk up to my front door. So on this return trip, I was happy to finally be able to put up a garage door and make the location a little more secure. My third base was in a second-story apartment just inside the city of Durkerdam, and also happens to be the location of my first bite, right outside the front door. Oh, the memories. What had happened was there was a zomboid banging on the front door, but I couldn't see him when I opened the door, so I tried to push past him, but that's when he grabbed me. And thus began the long and tedious journey of trying to make a cure, which has kept me busy for most of this playthrough. If I didn't show you the garage is one of my favorite places in all of Durkerdam. A little hole in the wall where I do all my mechanical work when I'm in the city. Anyways, enough with the nostalgia. I came back for a reason, to make the cure. So I spent a few days using the materials I had so painstakingly acquired to try to advance my vaccine knowledge, but no luck. I remained stuck on a level 3 vaccine, which was good, but not the full cure. All in all, I spent a little over a month in Durkerdam doing a bunch of God knows what. Fighting more respawns. Fighting more storm hordes. One time I almost blew myself up.
Oh, fuck.
I was losing my mind trying to get into a secret underground that never existed. It was only a clever illusion by the map maker. I even drove to the edges of the earth in search of the lost survivor colony that I never found. And I discovered instead that in Project Zomboid, the world is flat and at its edges merely drops off into a vast black abyss. The last real thing I did in Durkerdam was to get stubborn about visiting a military checkpoint, which took 3 whole days of fighting through an endless stream of Zeds just to get there. In the end, it was worth it because I was able to stock up on shotgun shells, 45, 556, and 308 ammo, as well as boxes of precious explosives, which I would make use of in the near future. The last couple of days, I loitered around the base, went fishing at my super secret fishing hole, and aggressively vented my frustrations on any zomboid that got near me. But at this point, I had my fill of Durkerdam. Things were getting stale. So I decided I would cross the bridge into West Point. The problem with that, however, was that there was a massive horde waiting for me on the other side. decided to stay the night on location and replenish my supplies from what was on hand in the frigate. It was at this point that things began to go wrong for me, and when it rains, it pours. First, I fell two stories while heavily overburdened, but somehow I was residually lucky enough to only shatter my shin. Honestly, I was surprised I didn't just die outright. I've never fallen from two stories that overburdened, and I injured myself worse those times. But whatever it was that saved me, I was thankful to be alive. The first thing I had to do now was to make a splint. I needed cloth and a plank, which was easy enough. My next mistake would be running out of cigarettes. I should have returned to base then and there, but I noticed my limp wasn't so bad. And because I had just killed like a bajillion Zeds, I thought for sure I'd be able to find some cigarettes on one of the bodies. But in some bizarre anti-miracle twist of fate, I found absolutely no cigarettes on any of the Zeds at all. I've never in my life ran through so many Zeds without finding cigarettes. But having a clear path into West Point, I figured I might as well check it out. Maybe I'd find some cigarettes there. Getting anxious from the lack of nicotine, so I finally decided I would simply head back to base. The truth is, I was overextended, not physically, but mentally. I was thinking about my injured shin and my need for tobacco. It made me blind to the sneaky Zed, and I was further distracted by the thought that a storm horde was forming. Judging by the way the Zeds outside had been moving, that was the last thing I needed right now. That's when it happened. A Zed, which I could not see while I was distracted by another Zed that I could see, took advantage of my open back and... God, that fucking sound is nasty. The permutations about how I would deal with this before I even got home were already circulating in my mind. I knew I had no vaccine-making materials at the lab. All I had was one level 3 vaccine there, and if it didn't cure me first tee, I'd be fucked. I'd also already completely scoured Durker Dam and over the river, and taken everything there was to take there. There's no immediately accessible sources of vaccine material available to me. My only real option was to loot the St. Peregrine Hospital in Louisville. Now, I've been there before, and that was not an option I liked one bit. But I knew I had no other choice. My hand was forced. To make matters more difficult, I had a limp, slight as it was, and my right arm was injured, which meant melee was out of the question, and would be for a while. Would be all guns from here on out. The only thing going for me in this entire fucked up situation was that I was first aid level 10, and I would recover faster than usual from such normally devastating injuries. The first thing to do now was to get the bear bus and bring it back to base. Needed to load it up with guns and ammo if I was gonna make an all-out assault on St. Peregrine's. But first I'd have to deal with a couple of curveballs, the first being that I was right about the Storm Horde. Because I hadn't been in Over the River for a little over a month, they were able to mount a decently sized respawn army that took most of the day to deal with. Technically, I might have ran away, they probably would have been there when I returned and everything would have been a mess. Plus, that just wasn't my style.
Thank you.
Second curveball thrown my way was that I had less albumin and level 1 vaccines on hand than I had thought. Albumin extends the length that vaccines work for. A level 1 vaccine chased with albumin tablets can usually keep you going for a couple of days before you'll need a fresh injection, so it was important. I didn't want to do it because I would be losing precious time, but I needed to head back to the lab first. There was more albumin there, and there was also that level 3 vaccine, which would buy me the most time of all and potentially cure me outright. But I wanted to hold off on using it until I secured more vaccine material, just in case. So I took a decent conditioned sport car I had laying around and made the trip back to the lab. The trip wasn't that bad all in all, taking only about 2.5 hours. At this point, it had been 24 hours since the bite. I was popping albumin every time my moodle went from queasy to nauseous, but it stopped working after 4 or 5 tablets. The way it works, as far as I can tell, is you get queasy at about 20% infection, you get nauseous at about 50%, and you get sick around 75 or 80. You have to take the albumin at some time between 50 or 60 or it won't do anything. I was going to need a fresh injection, but I was going to sleep first, letting my infection get around 90% before I took the next vaccine. I know what you're thinking. Sleeping at a time like this? And to be honest, the other times I was infected, I had forgone sleeping because I couldn't really afford to lose the time back then. Because I've always been prone to disease, I really only get about 1.5 days, maybe 2 days of delaying the infection. But if I was going to mount an all-out assault on St. Peregrine's, I would need my sleep. Everything about the outlook of this mission was already scuffed. You couldn't add fatigue into the equation. In the morning, I returned to the over-the-river base, dealing with the leftovers from the storm horde and doing some last-minute packing before finally departing for Louisville. Entered the outskirts of Louisville at about 5 o'clock, got to work clearing a path toward the hospital. I guess I should probably explain why I needed to raid the hospital and how the vaccine works. Firstly, there are 5 tiers of vaccine. The level 1 merely delays the infection. The level 2 delays the infection and has a 1 in 5 chance to cure you. As you progress through the tiers, the vaccines get better and more powerful until you create one strong enough to cure you outright. But creating vaccines is not for the squeamish or the faint of heart. You'll need to harvest a lot of blood from the corpses of dead Zeds, and I mean a lot. So keep a scalpel and a tweezer on you. You'll also need a lot of flasks, test tubes, and corks, which can either be found or crafted. Before you can really get started, though, you'll need to build a lab, which requires various carpentry, metalworking, and electrical materials. You'll also need some knowledge in these fields, as well as in first aid. But as you fill your pockets with blood, the first aid knowledge will flow. That's how I managed to get level 10 first aid, after all. Once you have the lab and the blood samples, you'll also need chemicals. There's a variety of these, but the most important ones are ammonia and sulfuric acid. These you use to craft ammonium sulfate, which is then used to extract leukocytes from blood samples or antibodies from the leukocytes, both of which are key components to the vaccines themselves. An important but overlooked aspect to all of this is the need for a water source. You'll need water and heat in order to sterilize and reuse all the flasks and test tubes that you'll be using. On top of that, you'll probably need a source of planks, which you can use to craft the many corks you will need. Lastly, advancing your vaccine knowledge is a bit of an arcane process. You find the magazines that teach you the recipes, but from those, you'll have to develop your own vaccine notes. In order to advance to level 2 and so on, you'll have to create or find a level 1 vaccine, and then successfully upgrade it, in which case you'll create your own notes for the next level of vaccine. But upgrading vaccines is a highly resource-intensive task. It's taken me at least 6 or 7 attempts before I've successfully upgraded any vaccines. Now, about St. Peregrine's Hospital. The main reason I'm going there is that it's the most likely place to have ammonia, which is the worst bottleneck in this entire process. As I've said before, I've already thoroughly sacked both Durker Dam and Over the River, and I've probably found about all the vaccine material in those places that I'm likely to find. The next most likely place to have vaccine material, which I happen to have a somewhat direct route into, is St. Peregrine's Hospital. The only problem with that is that it's St. Peregrine's Hospital. If you don't already know, it's one of the most dangerous, most heavily Zed-infested locations in post-Zomboid Kentucky. The only place with a higher Zed concentration is the Crossroads Mall. You can consider these two places the final bosses of Project Zomboid. Now I need that ammonia. The Peregrines has to have it, and if they don't, I'll become one of them. That being said, let's get into it. For the rest of the evening of the 6th, I continued working my way down the road toward the hospital, clearing Zeds to give myself the freedom of coming and going easily along the road. I worked late into the night and was fortunate enough to find a survivor vehicle to aid me on my quest. The bus isn't exactly very maneuverable and wouldn't be ideal as a daily driver for this situation. So I parked it on the bridge where it would become a base of sorts while I laid siege to the hospital and the surrounding area. The task for the 7th of March was to continue clearing the Zeds from the road and to clear the vehicles blocking the way. I'd also need to clear the Zeds occupying the office park and the space along the backside of the hospital. It was a delicate situation because I needed to evade the notice of the hospital Zeds, while at the same time clear the Zeds occupying the office park, so that I would have an escape route if things went bad at the hospital itself.
Thank you.
had also been popping albumin and pain pills all day to manage my injuries and the infection. But by the close of business that day, the albumin had stopped working. I would need another injection, but that would wait until tomorrow. It was on the 8th I decided that the office park bordering the hospital was sufficiently cleared, so I brought up two fully loaded miniguns in order to properly begin the siege of St. Peregrine's. It was about 11:30 in the morning by the time I finished with the first wave, and I noticed my infection moodle had elevated from nauseous to sick. So I took another round of the vaccine before continuing the fight. It was about 2 p.m. that afternoon that I had my first good news since this all began, as I found a bottle of ammonia on the corpse of a CDCZ. 7 p.m. that evening, I brought the second minigun up, but it seemed a little overkill for the situation, so I stuck with the Type 97 instead. Things would prove to be a little too hot to commit. I was still uncomfortable with how many Zeds were loitering outside. Foggy, which wasn't ideal for my mission, I decided to take a little detour to a nearby survivor house, but there wasn't anything too useful to me there. It was midday before I continued the fight at the hospital. There, the Peregrine Zeds would continue to put up a respectable resistance. Scenes and I would probably survive after all. This altered my quest somewhat. While I was already here, I wanted to be sure to fully loot the hospital and get absolutely everything I could to guarantee my survival before making the long trek back to the lab. But being the paranoid zomboid man freak show that I am, I was still uncomfortable with the idea of going inside. Not nearly enough Zeds have been pulled out yet. So I borrowed a car battery from a working Ford truck that I found in the parking lot, put it into the ambulance so I could use the siren to draw out even more Zeds. I did that for a little bit before heading into the office park to find a water dispenser. Call it a somewhat early night. The plan for the the day of the 10th was to full clear the hospital and wrap things up here. Now, going inside the hospital is a pretty scary thing. The truth is, despite everything, not all of the Zeds will have been pulled out by the racket I've been making outside. And I still had to worry about any Zeds on the front side of the building who might come in after me, which of course would probably happen sooner or later. It wasn't until about 5 a.m. the following morning that and I was satisfied I had ransacked the hospital to the best of my ransacking ability. While the medical supplies were indeed abundant, ammonia and sulfuric acid were not as abundant as I would have liked. Even though I fully cleared the hospital, I only came away with 4 bottles of ammonia. It was somewhat less than I was hoping for, but it was enough for the time being. The next thing to do now was to steal a vehicle for the long drive back. I didn't want to take the bus because it was bulky and slow. I considered the ambulance for a minute because it was fast, but I didn't like the storage situation. In the end, I took the Humvee. Driving back, I saw a CDCZ amongst a horde crossing the road, and I stopped to kill it, on the off chance that he had ammonia. And he did. Now I was feeling pretty good about my chances for survival. Oh well, I've survived worse. I arrived at the lab around 10 p.m. on the 11th. The albumin was still working from my latest injection, so I wasn't in a rush. It had been a week since the bite, and I'd taken 3 level 1 vaccines, but having come back with 5 bottles of ammonia, I was feeling pretty good. The next day, I began cooking up some vaccine. Evening, I spent some time getting gas and doing other chores, waiting until I got sick to take my first level 3 vaccine at about 6:30 in the evening. Then I worked on the Humvee for the rest of the night. The 13th, I spent doing random other things, but I never got queasy, which meant I was free of infection. For the sake of confirmation, I took a blood test, and it came back negative. I had cheated the Nox virus once again. Upon reflection, I suppose I overcooked things a little bit. Sweating over the raid of St. Peregrine's was a little unnecessary. Considering the first level 3 vaccine already in my possession cured me on its own. Oh well, at least I somewhat future-proofed myself against the next bite, which at my rate will probably happen sometime within the next 2 months.